Members, may I call to order the meeting of the panel on environmental affairs. Members should have received the agenda. Item 1, confirmation of minutes. Let's ask members to please endorse the minutes of the policy briefing committee held on the 23rd of January 2017. That's in paper CB bracket 1683/16-17. The Secretariat has not received any proposals for amendments. Can I please ask members to endorse the minutes? Thank you. Item 2, information papers issued since the last meeting. There has been none. And then item 3, items for discussion at the next meeting. Can we now invite the administration to come in now? The next regular meeting will be held on the 24th of April, a Monday at 2:30 p.m. The administration has proposed two items. One, manpower arrangement for implementation of measures on waste reduction and recycling. And B, construction of dry weather flow interceptors to improve water quality and reduce odor in Victoria Harbour and sewer rehabilitation in Kowloon, Sha Tin and Sai Kung. Members, any objection to having these two items on the agenda? If not, please mark them for the next meeting. Next item, the first discussion item, implementation arrangements for municipal solid waste charging. I'd like to welcome from the administration the team of officials, and you should have received two papers, one from the administration, one from the secretariat. We can now invite the administration to give a short introduction. But actually, this is a matter of concern for residents, and I'm sure members are well prepared for discussing this item, and only a very brief introduction is necessary. Secretary. Thank you, Chairman. Members. In early 2015, the Bureau proposed to the panel the framework arrangements for municipal solid waste charging. This is based on the principle of engaging stakeholders, and we have taken on board the views of different stakeholders in order to come up with the framework today. Now I will give a brief introduction on that. I think you know the policy objective. We cannot wait anymore in implementing MSW charging. Taipei City and Seoul started to do that 20 years ago. The waste disposal in these two cities dropped by some 30% in a matter of a few years. That goes to show that according to the polluter pays principle, MSW charging can bring about changes in behavior. And according to our blueprint, we'd like to reduce per capita waste disposal by 40% by 2022. I will be now speaking on the charging method, the different ways of collecting waste, etc. And under the principle of fairness, MSW charging will be implemented across the board at the same time. There will be two different ways to do it. The first one is to charge by bag, and the other one is by volume. And this would apply the by bag method means that people have to use prepaid designated garbage bags, and this would apply to direct collection service by FEHD. And for by volume charging, this would apply to contractors taking refuse to the refuse collection point. And as for the charging level, I think that is what members are concerned about. You must understand that this is to reduce waste but not to get more revenue for the government. We are proposing that it should be 11 cents for each litre. This is a charge in between that charge by Taipei City and Seoul. Supposing a family uses a 15-litre designated bag, they may have to pay $1.10 to $1.70 every day. As for large-scale dumping, and the label charge would be $11 across the board. And the gate fee will be $365 or $395 per ton. And this is in line with the proposals of the Sustainable Development Council. Members of the public would have to take time to adapt to this and also to effect a behavioral change. So we propose to preserve the charging level for 3 years. As for individual buildings or other buildings that need to have time to adjust their collection method, there will be a 3-year transitional period, and they will be able to pay according to the collective charges for the FEHD RCV fleet. In the last week, members of the public have expressed concern about enforcement. There will be 2 levels of enforcement. If at the RCP, there will be refusal of waste taken there without a label or without the designated prepaid bags. And also, if there is any violation, there will be prosecution or a fixed penalty of $1,500 levied. And because of privacy and resource concerns, we will react to complaints or reports, and we will also draw up a list of black spots, and we'll target those. We understand that the public will need to adapt to the new rules and regulations and also effect behavioral change. So we believe that in the first 6 months, the enforcement agencies would issue warnings to lawbreakers so that they can gradually adapt to the changes. Publicity and education. Enforcement is necessary, but at the same time, and more importantly, we should enhance the awareness of the public towards waste reduction and clean recycling and to effect behavioral change. These are the important considerations for cities that have succeeded in MSW charging. We'll mount publicity to spread the message to the public and also different stakeholders. And we will also engage the Conservation and Environment Fund stakeholders in order to get everybody prepared. In terms of recycling resources, we understand the public are concerned about complementary measures. We will provide more recycling support. We, before the charging is levied, the overall proportion between refuse bin and recycling bins will be enhanced from 1 to 6 to 1 to 14. And we will also provide outreach services in order to promote separation of waste by at source. And also there are 2 producer responsibility schemes, that for waste electronic products and also glass beverages. That will be implemented soon, and also the integrated waste collection point or organic waste collection service will be kickstarted soon to collect food waste. We are taking different measures in order to provide appropriate recycling support for different kinds of waste. And the MSW charging system is an opportunity to arouse the public's awareness of the different types of materials that can be recycled. All in all, we expect the MSW charging scheme to be able to get your support, and then in the first half of the year, we can propose the bill to LegCo. Supposing the LegCo needs 1 year to scrutinize the bill and also to set up a 12 to 18 month preparatory period, the charging scheme can be introduced at the earliest in the second half of 2019. This has been on the drawing board for a long time, and previous consultation has indicated that there is general support. There will be the threshing out of details, and also it concerns many different stakeholders, but we are confident that this can bring about behavioral changes. As you know, a journey of 1,000 miles starts with the first step. And of course, the bill will be scrutinized by a bills committee, but we must make this first step so the society will be able to dump less and save more and produce less waste. We're happy to take questions. Thank you, Secretary. We have a team of officials from the Bureau and also the EPD. I am going to assign 4 minutes for each member to ask questions because the other item is also very important. Now, 9 members would like to speak. Well, I will have to calculate the time again, but we'll start with 4 minutes. Our meeting will end at 5 p.m. And I also like to tell you that according to the paper, it is expected that in the second quarter of the year, there will be a bill to be tabled at LegCo. And in a moment, we'll listen to your views about that. Okay, without further ado, Mr. Gary Chan.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I support this principle of polluter pays and two approaches, that is by household, by bag, and by volume. And when it comes to the charging level, it has to be reasonable, and you also have to take care of the grassrooters and the vulnerable groups. However, when it comes to a scheme, we have to look at the details. Now, society is very concerned about illegal dumping, and the Secretary said that there would be about 100 staff members doing work in this area, including education and publicity. But in Hong Kong, there are many multi-story buildings and many rural areas, so you just have 100 officers. I don't think it's enough to handle the illegal dumping problem. Now, after the charging scheme has started, there will be many more cases of illegal dumping, and there may be rubbish queues in various parts of the territory. We don't want to see that, because as a result of the charging scheme, there may be more illegal dumping. I really don't want to see that. And also, for the past 5 years, the government hasn't done much to help the recycling business, and there is only a recycling fund of $1 billion. So for this MSW charging scheme, I hope that after you collected the charges, a fund should be set up to help the recycling industry. If the money is just put into the cover, I don't think the public will be happy. Now, the government already has a huge amount of reserves, so we really want this sum of money to be put into the recycling industry. Then the public would feel happier to pay the charge. And also, there must be appropriate ancillary facilities. Over half of the domestic waste is kitchen waste or food waste. If you do not provide ancillary facilities, that's not fair. So I hope that you can respond to these questions. Mr. Chen, thank you for your support of the general direction of the scheme. As for the details, we would have to discuss further. I would like to respond to two of your questions. For overseas countries, when they implement MSW charging, in the first stage, most of them would not provide enough facilities for recycling of food waste, and it's even more challenging here than in Taipei and Seoul. So we already have a plan for the coming years. Well, first we will start with the commercial and industry sectors, and then we will target domestic premises. For example, Taipei also started waste charging first, and then after 4 years, they started to handle food waste. And even in the 8th year, they were only collecting 180 tons of food waste a year. Now, with our new integrated face handling center, we would already be handling food waste. But in Hong Kong, we do not have a big agricultural sector, so we would have to work in accordance with our plans. So our blueprint is very clear. As for supporting the recycling sector, the government has done a lot. Lately, I've been talking to the industry. They think that charging by load is very important. So if this is done, then they would implement strategies to recycle more. Thank you. Next, Mr. Wen, please be succinct. We have 17 members waiting. As for the grand direction, yes, I support the policy of charging by volume of waste, because this will become an incentive and this will drive behavioral change. But I'm also very concerned about the details. That is, how can this grand target be reached? Now, 40% of domestic waste is food waste, and I'm very concerned about the integrated waste center. And on page 10 of the paper, you say that through the environmental campaign committee, more bins will be provided to residential buildings. Yes, you might have done something, but this is a hardware, and if you do not manage to not follow up, then nothing can be done. So for OCs, will you be talking to them or giving them assistance so that they can work with recyclers, so and a mechanism be set up? So if waste is worth some money, then people will pay more attention to it. However, for the recyclers, after when they collect the recyclables, of course they would pay, but what would happen to the waste? How can it be recycled into something useful? Now, in the past, we've seen bad examples. So I think eventually we have to do something at the source, and also for the grassrooters, because when it comes to the disposing of waste, I think we produce more or less the same amount of waste per day. However, for the charge, it may be quite expensive for the grassrooters. So when you implement the relevant measures, will you have plans to help the grassrooters? Now, if they, they may not be able to afford the charge, and that may become a vicious cycle. For example, when it comes to the designated garbage bags, would you subsidize them? Or would you implement your plan in stages so that they can get accustomed to the new practice more easily? Now, thank you for your support. First, when it comes to food waste, it accounted for 40% of landfills when I first took my office, but now that there have been improvements, and it's reduced by 30%, that's several hundred tons of food waste. And the new integrated center will be handling 200 tons a day, and in the future will be 300 tons a day. So in the future, the handling capacity of food waste will be 500 tons. And the private sector will also be taking a part in the collection of food waste, because it means money. And for the private market, if recycling can help them earn money, of course, they will also take part. So for your question, in the future, the problem may not be so serious. So in this coming days, recyclables can be sold and the whole ecosystem will be changed. And later on, we will also be looking at the producer responsibility scheme for plastic bottles. Elizabeth Port. Thank you, Madam Chair. The government has taken reference from other cities, and it is found that MSW charging is effective in reducing waste. So I support that. But if you look at other places, other than penalty, they also have rewards. That is, they would use both the stick and the carrot. Now, in Seoul, I think they have very successful examples. And other than charging, they would also provide rewards. Now, they would record the household waste load, and if they have accumulated a certain amount of points, then they would enjoy a water charge reduction, etc. But now what we are doing here is quite different. We just impose penalty. It's different from other places' success stories. Now we are trying to promote a smart city, and we know that technology can solve a lot of problems. I think this is also applicable to waste management. While we are promoting a smart city, and while we are trying to reduce waste, can we also implement this kind of system, that is, with both carrots and sticks? Thank you for your comments. Yes, we understand that Seoul has successfully driven a behavioral change in the citizens. So when I look at the Taipei and Seoul examples, I saw that legislation was the foundation. And then with waste charging, they accumulated data. They were able to measure the waste load from offices and domestic premises. So there was a yardstick to measure, and then they could make comparison, and later on they were able to set up a reward scheme. We have visited Seoul. And when it comes to recycling, well, in terms of food waste, they are now charging by load. So there are different benchmarks. So we can be creative when it comes to providing incentive. Even for our community green stations, the people who brings the waste there can also accumulate points. So for different housing estates, if they achieve well under the scheme, maybe a reward can be provided. We can think about that in the future. Chairman, well, the Secretary said that yes, this can be considered, but when you first launch it, you just have penalty, but there's no reward. So people will think that this is a lot of trouble, they have to pay more, but there's no encouragement. So when you first launch it and there's no incentive, then people may not support your scheme. So to attract the support of people, maybe you should think of giving them rewards so that they will be encouraged to take part in the scheme. Yes, these are the details. If we agree on the general direction, then we can come up with more creative ideas. Mr. Martin Liu. Now, for Hong Kong's management of MSW, it has always been an urgent problem. In the past, the government was not able to solve the problem. As for this term of government, now it proposes a new scheme, that is the MSW charging scheme. I support that. It was introduced because of the recommendation of the SDC. That's a recommendation, but it's very difficult to implement. So maybe you can take reference from the past, for example, the cleaning campaign and the smoking ban. And I have a question about paragraph 24. It is said that after the initial period, the government will enforce the law stringently. Now, I think this is very important because you want to control people's behaviors. In 2013 to 2015, the government has handled 6,000 to 8,000 complaints against illegal dumping. And now we are talking about domestic waste. The government has handled illegal dumping in the past. So can you tell me this? In the future, will there be many more cases? And will the government have enough manpower to enforce the law so as to make sure that this scheme is workable? Deputy Director, when it comes to law enforcement, we will be carrying this out in two phases. Can you speak closer to the microphone? I think that's a design problem with our microphone.
There are two levels of law enforcement, one at RCVs and RCPs, where collection is done. The frontline staff, when they see no prepaid designated bags are used, they will refuse to accept the refuse. And we will also do enforcement upstream. Mr. Liao mentioned estimated figures, and he asked us for our estimate. Well, that will depend on whether the public find our enforcement action acceptable and what the Bills Committee thinks about our proposals. And I'd like to mention that when we do this, there will be a half a year transitional or adaptation period. We hope that members of the public can change the behavior in that period of time so there will be more compliance. Martin Liao, I'd like to ask you whether you have the manpower to do enforcement and prosecution. Have you planned for that? I expect a big number at the beginning. Even with a six-month transitional period, I'm sure there will be quite a number of violations. Thank you. As I was saying, that really depends on the details of enforcement and the overall arrangement for taking out action after the bill is passed. We certainly will increase manpower for the purpose, but the actual figures have to be laid down only when an overall strategy is mapped out. Frankie Yick, thank you. No one would object to the overall direction, but as some members were saying, I'd like also to ask about some details. I'm speaking on para 20, and that is the collection bins. It is said that the waste producer will have to prepay the charge. There will be a big problem. Let me cite you this example. You can talk to the restaurants how much waste they usually produce every day. It would be a certain tonnage, and then it's $1,500 to take the refuse away, including depreciation of the vehicles and the transportation, etc. But the gate fee for one ton is about like $500, let's say. And as I was saying, we collect $1,500 for a ton, so it's about $50 each day for transportation. But then I have to prepay the $500 gate fee. And you can know the risk they face every month. 70% of the refuse collection contractors operate their own vehicle, and they just cannot take that kind of risk. As you know, eateries can open today and close tomorrow. Your paper says this should be the subject of consultation between the producer and the collector. But this is impossible. Have you thought about reducing the risk for eateries? And I can again give you an example. It's just like export credit insurance. Can you take out an insurance if there is any default and winding up of business? Then there can be compensation paid by the insurer. Number two, the vehicle can, say, for example, collect 10 tons of refuse, and it goes to 10 waste producers to collect that waste. Unless everyone will weigh the refuse right away, or else, how can they apportion the charging? And even if there is a scale, whose scale should it be? I think all these details have to be threshed out. You have produced the paper, but you only say it should be discussed and agreed on mutually agreeable payment agreements. And you also talk about a hybrid system, but I have asked the industry. They haven't heard anything about it. It is in the paper here, but no one has heard about it. So two questions. One, apportioning of charge, and also there are operating risks. Deputy Director. Thank you, Chairman. In fact, the charging of the gate fee is like this. The SDC also proposed a way of charging, and that is it will charge the facility user, meaning the private waste collector. The collector will pay the gate fee at the facility. This is not unique to Hong Kong. When other cities charge for MSW, that is the arrangement, and that is the facility user pays the gate fee. This is a proposal from the SDC. And then we talked to the industry about the gate fee, and we asked them whether there will be operational difficulties, and they told us that it should not be strictly for collectors to pay the fee. They think that in certain circumstances it should be paid upstream, meaning the waste producer. So we talk about hybrid system in the paper. After listening to the industry, this is a more flexible approach. The waste producer or the waste collector can hold the future account and pay. Chairman, just one word. If there is no strict rule, it will be very difficult. Okay, Ray Chan. Thank you, Chairman. I think the Bureau Chief knows, and we have already given a submission. We are of the view that to effectively reduce waste, we must mandate and compel separation of waste at source, and then you can have recycling. The waste that cannot be separated should be the subject of waste charging, but that is for the long term. And you said you have to wait till the next step to mandate a separation of waste at source because there are many difficulties. But please do not underestimate the difficulties of this charging scheme, because the public can easily ask 10, 20 questions which cannot be easily answered. You say there will be an adaptation period of 6 months, and in that period you will refuse to take the waste that is not in order, and you will issue a warning to violations. So what happens? You don't accept the waste, you don't prosecute, and people are unwilling to use the bags. Then what happens? Someone would have to come up with a legal bag, so to speak. And the Housing Department is asking me whether demerit points should be recorded. And I said, it's all right, if you do so, they will take the refuse out of the estate boundary, and that will solve the problem for the Housing Department. I believe there should be separation of waste at source considered together with this charging scheme. And then I have a fundamental question for you. In fact, we have asked that already. And that is double charging, effecting in unfairness. This has not been answered by members. You know, we pay rates, and rates would mean that the government should be taking away the waste. And if you charge for MSW collection and you do not reduce the rates, it will not be fair. In the last session at our panel, we passed a motion, and that is if MSW charging is launched, the panel would request the government or require the government to at the same time reduce rates so that there will not be double charging. Have you dealt with that issue? Thank you, Chairman. In Hong Kong, the per capita waste production exceeds all other Asian cities. That is a fact. Look at Taipei, Seoul. They have succeeded in reducing the waste production per capita in just a few years after the charging scheme is launched. So in principle, many people support the early implementation of the scheme. You talk about rates. when the SDC engaged the public, there was already discussion in the community. The mainstream view is that the two are not related. Say I'm a tenant. The rates is paid by the owner. Whether or not I produce waste, the rates would be paid. It doesn't include waste collection. Can I read out the definition of rates for you? Well, we have a different view. And I don't think that is fair, because we are now giving play to the polluter pays principle. The rates are set according to the rateable value, and it has nothing to do with the load of waste produced. How can the two be mixed up? And the charging by volume means that whether you rent or own your own place, if you produce a lot of waste, we believe the charging scheme will help you reduce waste. And we are not going by the cost recovery principle, but we are facing a bigger and bigger problem of waste producing. The two should be separated. In fact, we are charging quite a reasonable amount. Thank you, Tommy Zheng. I raise my hand after you. Of course, I will be mentioning this point. I have said this since 1995. Starting from the charging of the trade affluence surcharge, I have been talking about this. My memory tells me that it was Donald Zhang who mooted this, and I said it was his masterpiece. But the polluter pays principle was agreed to by the public, and they say the restaurants should only be charged the most. But Secretary, you don't like to meet me, and I have no time really to meet with you, but I have said many times that you say rates are not defined in the papers, but maybe before you were born, those people who collected human waste did not enjoy any rates collection. It was only after we have had water latrines that we started to collect rates, and the rates were for the municipal councils until the year 2000, when the municipal councils were abolished. But the two municipal councils were responsible for taking away waste and collection and all that. But our rateable value has been climbing, so you are collecting a lot in rates. When you say there is no direct relationship between rates and waste, and as you know, many people are saying they are not paid as much as they work. And some people are saying, I come here to put the blame on others, and I just hold meetings, and then I get paid a lot. You should thank Mr. Ray Chan for telling you that, in fact, Tommy Zheng does not act alone. I have the support of many colleagues, because this charging scheme is totally unfair. I am sitting in between Elizabeth Quart and Ray Chan, and I thank them. We have been talking about this for 20-odd years. Don't just use the stick, but you should offer the carrot. Last week, in an oral question, you talk about food waste, and I already asked you why you can't produce a tax break to the restaurants. You can reduce some tax, and then the restaurants would be happy to recycle the waste. You say you provide help to the NGOs. But what about the catering industry? We need to separate the waste. We need to clean up the used bowls or bottles. And that is costly. And of course, we like to discharge our CSR. But what does the administration do? The administration would always go for administrative convenience. You can calculate the administration cost. You say civil servants are expensive. Well, yes, but what about our administrative cost? Who will pay it? Of course, you will say as long as you can have enough votes, you will try to rush through with this. I don't think so this time around. Mr. Ray Chan, my filibuster, and you are not getting the support of the DAB. And the Liberal Party is speaking up. Mr. Xiu Ka-fai has yet to speak. So think about it. Don't always quote Taipei and Seoul. Other people have got laws for waste oil, and they get all the certification before exporting it to other countries. Why don't you do this? We have been asking you to do something for a few years. I don't know whether you are deaf or I don't speak out loudly enough. So don't talk about me, about other countries. But I trust Hong Kong people. I think education is important, even today. Even if we separate the ways, you are not doing your part. How can you now charge people? Thank you, Tommy Jung. Edward, you?
Thank you. I've talked to the secretary before. Well, for property management industry, it has major concerns about this piece of legislation. Now, for housing estates, they have waste shafts. So in the middle of the night, if they dump waste into that shaft without a bag, then, well, in the morning, the FEHD may refuse to collect that bag of waste, and then the estate would have to pay. So this would cause a lot of problems for the property management companies, and is afraid that the responsibility will be shifted onto them. So I hope that enough support can be given to them. Just now, members have asked about this. That is, after you've collected the charge, would you do something to make people feel that they've been really contributed to the environment? For example, if waste has been significantly reduced at a certain housing estate, maybe you can subsidize that estate to buy certain green facilities, for example, food waste machine, etc. Then they would think that by supporting the government to reduce waste, they can have some gains for themselves. And also under the existing law, in particular, dumping waste in the rural areas is a huge problem, and it's very difficult to enforce the law. So if you don't do anything in the future, then owners of farmlands may open their land, their sites for dumping, and this in the future may become a problem. Just now you talked about property management companies. Yes, we attach a lot of importance to their opinions. So when we implement a charging scheme, we also need the housing estates to help us to implement the arrangement. So in the past, we have been communicating with the property management companies. They have given us a lot of views. In particular, they are worried about upstream. That is, when it comes to illegal dumping, they do not have the power to enforce the law. So other than the refuse collection points at different housing estates, we would also authorize our officers to take action. That is, if they receive complaints, they can take enforcement actions. So when we talk to the management, property management companies, they already knew that this can help allay their concern. And also for recycling facilities, that is, whether we would encourage more recycling. Now, when it comes to MSW charging, yes, when you dump waste, you will be charged. So if you do not dump so much, you may save money. So there is already a financial incentive. This is my answer. Dr. Yu, how about illegal dumping of construction materials? We have talked about this on various occasions. Now, we are trying to make more efforts. For example, we are asking the relevant vehicles to install GSP. Yes, we agree to the direction, but our focus is on waste reduction, not on charging. For grassrooters, $3 per bag may be a burden on them. So for people living in public housing estate or for grassrooters, can you give them the bags for free? So if they cannot use up the bags, they can also sell the bags. So then this would help them create an incentive. It's not like giving them money, but it's to encourage them to reduce waste production. And after collecting the charges, can the money be used for promoting environmental protection? For example, you can subsidize private housing estates to buy food waste machines. And also, I would like to remind the Secretary, just now Tommy Chong has talked about race, and race includes waste collection fees. Well, it's stated in a paper in 1935. It started in the anti-first and then it spread to Xin Wan. So the race do cover waste collection charge. So can you lower the race before launching MSW charging? Deputy Director, with regard to race, just now the Secretary has already replied to you. And for the present race is an indirect tax, is part of the government's revenues. It's for the government's expenditure, but it's not solely used for waste collection. In 1935, the government started to charge race in the NT. So from 1935 onwards in Tuen Mun, Yulong and Taibo, this was already introduced and thus covered waste collection. Please let me continue. Waste is part of the government's revenue and is to pay for the government's expenditures. It's not only used for waste collection. As for the calculation of race, is mainly related to the rental level. For example, when there's a vacant flat, race still have to be paid, but there's no waste to be collected. And for two units, their race may be different, but the volume of their waste may be the same. Yes, we understand that members are very concerned about the livelihood of grassrooters. But if you look at Seoul and Taipei, they also have MSW charging. They also have grassrooters and vulnerable groups. They do not subsidize them. They do not give them free garbage bags. So when SDC conducted its public engagement exercise, it recommended to the government, that is, whether we can take better care of the grassrooters. So that's why we are also taking that into consideration. Mr. Wu Chi-wai, my first question is about double charging. I have my view first. Now, for this MSW charging, the Secretary has never told us how the money will collected will be spent. Can it be spent on promoting environmental protection? And for rates are paid by landowners, but it may be the tenant who's generating the waste. So if we are to target the waste generator, then certain arrangements should be made targeting the tenant. The secretary has been talking about the values of resources. Well, yes, that's a very important tool for the development of the recycling industry. Now, in housing estates, aluminium cans, metals, and in the future, electrical appliances, they will be collected. However, plastic bottles and food waste will not be collected in such an effective manner. So with such MSW charging, you may turn these materials into valuable ones. So how can you help people recycle these materials more easily? For people who would like to reduce their living costs, there should be easy ways to do them. Now, these recyclables are very difficult to be collected. So there are strategies to improve that, so that when you implement your future arrangements, such recyclables can be collected through effective channels. But there are two aspects. First, we all agree that for this MSW charging is not to increase the government's revenue. It is to create a system so that we would know that if we dump more, we have to pay more. Well, for this term of government, yes, Madam Chair, I understand. I'm sorry, many members have asked the same questions. That is about this MSW charging. Would the money collected be used for a specific purpose? Okay, there's no carrot. So would the MSW charges be used for a particular purpose? Now, for this term of government, now before implementing the MSW charges, actually we have already put in a lot of efforts. So for the money that we collect, well, I don't think he understands my question. When it comes to the recycling of glass bottles, yes, now they do not worth a lot of money. So we try to launch a producer responsibility scheme. In the past, the glass bottle recycling scheme coverage was very small, but now it's extended to a lot of areas, including some commercial buildings. I don't think the secretary is answering our questions. He's just repeating his old answers. Sukafai, thank you. Well, last year, when we looked at the little containers in the streets, their openings were made smaller and didn't know why. And now I understand, because now you are afraid that people would move their dump their domestic waste in the little containers on the street. Now, user pays. Yes, this has been Hong Kong's principle. That is, when you do more, you make more money, and when you dump more, you waste more, etc. So for people like us, we have been paying rents. I think many members have talked about this. The secretary said that for MSW charging is not to increase the government's revenue. But this is what we see. That is, the money will be put in the treasury, and the people are really doubly charged. Well, if you reduce rents, you say that, well, only the land or the property owners will benefit, tenants won't. But in the future, there can be agreements between tenants and property owners. So this is very clear. It's double charging. When you implement the MSW charging, can you really do something about race? Otherwise, a lot of people will think it's not fair. I'm also a district councillor, and for some residents in my constituency, they have WhatsApped me saying that this is not fair. So other than a stick, a carrot is very important as well. This is point number one. And point number two, well, I was talking about Lau Kong Hwa's small opening litter container is for deterring people to dump big waste in. So for a lot of places in Hong Kong, you can see illegal dumping of construction and demolition materials, and it's very difficult to prosecute the culprits. They may put several big bags on hillside, and you will never be able to catch them. You have to spend a lot of money to move them to landfills. Now, these people are trying to avoid to pay the landfill fee. In the future, if people are not too clear about the new legislation, they may be accidentally caught by the law, and the fine level is very high. So how can you make sure that there will not be more illegal dumping cases? And how can you make sure that people won't be caught by the law unexpectedly? You have less than 1 minute left. Well, maybe I can give my time to Mr. Ray Chen.
He was talking about something, and the main point is race. A few members have said that race should include waste collection charges, but the Bureau differs in opinion. Please explain that. Thank you, Mr. Xiu, for supporting the new law in principle. Two aspects. One, we agree stepping up publicity and education. According to SDC's proposal, there will be a year to a year and a half's preparatory period for the government, the community, and the business community. And even after it is implemented, there will be half a year leniency period, allowing more communication. And also there will be outreach services to tell people how they should understand the law. I will ask for a hearing. Thank you. Thank you for mentioning that. Eddie Chu. Thank you, Chair. In principle, I support the scheme. I do hope the law can come within the year for first reading. Bureau Chief, I don't know whether you are going to stay on. If it's a different person, I don't want the law to disappear. This is my basic stance. Many people are concerned about enforcement and whether there are complementary facilities to help people when particularly you want to penalize people. I'd like to ask about 2 points. One, collection and recycling. How can we do more over and above what is being done? Number one, we heard the Secretary mention the proportion between refuse bins and collection bins for different kinds of waste, and there will be an adjustment. But what about RCPs? Will there be any adjustment to complement the charging scheme? In other words, that the FEHD RCPs will be able to function also as a recycling spot. Maybe not recycling, but a spot for the sharing of resources for the sake of the community. Actually, there are 4 community green stations, and we still lack 10 odd more. Can CGS be positioned better so that you will complement what the FEHD is doing? Very often, the CGS are not easily accessible and is not very effective. So RCPs and then CGS. Number two, landfills. Some contractors are telling me that when they collect waste from FEHD RCPs, they take it to a transfer station and then to landfills. Before they go to a transfer station, they would actually have liked to separate the source and take out what is reusable. But according to the law, and also the agreement between the government and the landfill operators, they can't do that now. When you implement the charging scheme, can you also review the present restrictions that contractors cannot separate the reusable resources? So can you adjust the contracts between yourselves and these collectors? Deputy Director, Number one, RCPs and complementary recycling facilities. When the charging scheme is implemented, the bureau chief will head a committee to review the arrangements for recycling bins and also refuse collection bins. We understand that at our RCPs now, not every RCP has recycling facilities. To complement this charging scheme, where appropriate, we'll retrofit RCPs with recycling bins. There will be more of them with larger sizes. Secondly, when the charging scheme is launched, will we change existing collection arrangements? When the SDC proposes the framework, one important principle is that it should be based on the existing waste collection arrangement. Therefore, there will not be big changes. As for CGS and its positioning, and whether there will be duplication of resources between CGS and RCPs, I'd like to say that actually CGS is mainly to support low-value recyclables. But we have a waste reduction subcommittee where detailed discussion can take place. Next, Mr. Kenneth Leung. One basic question. I have been asking this for a few years, and that is charging and waste reduction. What is the correlation between the two in terms of statistics? You charge a small fee, and this will be more expensive than buying a waste bag. But statistically, I don't know how you arrive at that correlation. Even if you launch the scheme, can you have a trial period of 12 months first? Because I can't see that correlation. You're telling me Taipei and Seoul have succeeded in doing this, that they have achieved good results. But let us look at deep-seated structural issues. This may have something to do with the culture and mindset and even the quality of the people. Some people may reduce waste without a charging scheme. Well, I haven't studied this in depth, but people pay a small charge to buy a bag, and you say there is a direct correlation between that and waste reduction. I'm not convinced. I have read economics. Can you explain to me this concept? Bureau Secretary, I've asked you this question for 3-4 years. I support the direction, all right, but this is the basic question that is still baffling me. Secretary. Chairman, thank you, Mr. Leung. Thank you for supporting the basic direction. Let us look at Hong Kong, the shopping bag levy. It is not a big sum, but in the first stage, that applied to supermarkets and chain stores, and the use was reduced by 80%, 90%. And Hong Kong people were found to be very sensitive to such fee charging schemes. And in fact, in the last week, people are already asking whether their estate provides recycling facilities. In fact, some estates do recycle glass beverages, but bottles, but people might not know it. However, once they heard about the scheme, they were starting to ask about it. So Hong Kong people are reacting very fast. We did public engagement with the support of the Environment Fund. The simulated exercises showed that, of course, the fee was not really charged, but even for business and estates, there was already waste reduction, even in a simulated pilot scheme. And we could see some marked results. you can understand that people seem to pay a lot of attention to economic measures. And I'm sure the charging scheme can enhance people's awareness of waste reduction and clean recycling. In the last week, members of the public were asking us whether there are recycling facilities. As you know, we have this big waster website. And those who are environmentally conscious would go and look for information. But when the charging scheme is going to be implemented, people are already starting to look around for recycling facilities. They want to know where the facilities are. We see some positive response. This will be the engine for launching this scheme. Next, Ted Hui. Thank you, Chairman. The DPNI support waste charging. We are still discussing principles and we would always support it, but we now have questions about the details. But I don't want the details to bog down the project. And I'd like to make the following points. Number one, at the initial stage, the fee must not be too high. As I always say, the law should be there to educate. We don't want you to scare people so they do not produce waste because of a high charge, but then you should educate them to reduce producing waste. The biggest opposition is that people want to argue about this. Why do they want to argue? It's because you charge them, but you do not provide a package of recycling facilities. The people are saying, I want to dump less waste. I'm putting bulbs and food waste and electric or electronic equipment aside, and I'm waiting for them to be recycled, but I don't know where to take them. You say you have CGS, but then only a few stations are operated and they are not effective. They are accepting very little waste and they are not meaningful. And then your $1 billion environment fund, people are criticizing it. You are not helping businesses because few people apply. And in terms of recycling, what are you doing? Do you also commit that some recycling initiatives will be included in your charging scheme so people know you have the resolve to do recycling? Let me hear from you how you can convince the public they should pay a charge because you are providing recycling. Thank you for supporting the direction. I think to a certain extent, this is a question of chicken and egg. In the community, the recycling of neon lights, batteries, and electric bulbs, the facilities are there. If you want to look for them, there are mobile applications that can identify them for you. And I have asked estates whether they provide recycling for glass, and they say yes, but the residents don't know it. But you can use a mobile application and you will know. 80% of residential buildings now provide glass recycling. So to answer you, there will be at least two aspects which will be boosted in the preparatory stage. There will be recycling of glass, plastic, paper, and metal. The Environment Fund will support the installation of recycling bins and will also increase the collection of plastic bottles which have a low recycling value. In the policy address, we said there will be more facilities provided in order to complement this MSW charging scheme. And then CGS is operating smoothly, and with the accumulation of experience, they are recycling 1 ton of waste every day. It is not a small volume, but we are going to step up publicity. And after charging by volume, people will be looking hard for these recycling bins. and will be able to increase the effectiveness of waste recycling. Thank you, Mr. Kenneth Lau. Public engagement was concluded in 2011. There is a lot of public support. According to the paper from the administration, after launching the scheme, waste disposal will be reduced by 40% by 2022. I support the polluter pays principle and charging by volume. But the administration must consider, as many members have said, the needs of CSSA and grassroots households. And what about singleton elderly people? They may not understand the scheme, and they may not even know where they can buy the prepaid bags. You say there are mobile applications, and at the same time, you should enhance the public's desire to reduce waste. And there is a lack of recycling facilities as of now, and also you need to tackle illegal dumping.
So for the new territories, there are many villages which are very remote. So how can you make sure that for the villagers living in those places can buy designated garbage bags, and how many automatic selling machines will be set up in the NT? There are now about 2,600 waste collection points. Some of them are small, some of them are big. So recycling facilities should be provided in all the waste collection points. If you can enhance your recycling facilities, it would help people a lot. And also in the rural areas, there is a serious problem of dumping oversized waste, and nobody would get the refuse collection points. So how are you going to enforce the law? Thank you for your questions. Well, for Hong Yi Cook, when we conducted our public engagement exercise, it has given us a lot of support. We have talked to rural representatives, and there have been a lot of communications. So when it comes to promoting the reduction of waste, they have helped us a lot. The member has asked three questions. First, about the purchase of designated garbage bags. There will be over 4,000 sale points in the rural areas. We can also set up selling machines. So in the remote areas, designated garbage bags can also be bought. And also for the recycling facilities in the rural areas, in the refuse collection points in the rural areas, they may not have appropriate recycling facilities at the moment, but we will enhance this in the future, and we will talk to the villages in the rural areas. And you also talked about elderly. Yes, we are very concerned about them. Not only about those living in villages, we are also concerned about those living in old districts. So in terms of publicity and education, we will set outreach teams to communicate with them so that they would know where to buy the bags and they would know more about clean recycling. And also for illegal dumping, we have communicated with different villages. If there are black spots, we will enhance our enforcement. Dr. Kwokaki, Mr. Kwawaika. For waste charging, we have been talking about it for a long time. I remember for the last term of council, we visited Seoul. So, well, South Korea has done a good job in this regard. As for Singapore and Taiwan, they have also progressed significantly in this regard. So I hope that this charging scheme will be a good beginning for us, and we can soon catch up. As for changing people's behavior waste charging is one of the ways, but one only is not enough. So what would happen to the recyclables after separating them as source? Now we have to export most of them. Locally, we do not have manufacturing industries which can make use of recyclables. Now, food waste can be used for composting, but we don't have agriculture in Hong Kong. So if food waste can only be composed, now we are still doing it. And after that, we would have to send them to places where people are still farming. So does it mean that we are benefiting other countries? But I think we should look at it from another perspective. Now, we are just sending away something that's useful, but it cannot be used by us. So even if the government has to pay for the shipping cost, it's still not a lot of money. So I think it's meaningful. And also another member mentioned this, that is for public housing residents and elderly people, we should show our concern. I'm not saying that the bags should be for free. However, now in public housing estates, the garbage bags are free. So we really have to tackle this issue. These are minute details, but they really have to be ironed out. Otherwise, there will be disputes. And also, I'm very concerned about elderly households. To be frank, to reduce waste is related to a person's educational level, his character, his living habit, his concept of waste reduction, etc. So for the elderly people, we have to be more concerned about them because they have been leading their lives in a certain way for decades. If you suddenly force them to change their behavior, this would mean a huge pressure. So for the elderly people who are receiving old age allowance or old age living allowance or CSSA, would you provide them with some assistance? So a certain incentive should be provided to them. But for waste reduction, we do not only rely on phase charging, but this would take the lead. Other policies will follow. As for recyclables, we handle them in different ways. For glass bottle recycling, well, most of the recycled glass can be used in Hong Kong. As for food waste, we can adopt a multi-pronged approach. Well, turning food waste into energy is the mainstream approach now in big cities. But of course, we are also very concerned about the underprivileged groups. Mr. Liang Qichang, I agree with the Secretary. Yes, if you want to embark on a 1,000-mile journey, you have to take the first step. So the MSW charging scheme is the first step. So how are we going to do it in a proper way? I support the implementation of the scheme, but of course there are still details that we need to take care of. Now, because you will be charging people money, so of course there will be a lot of repercussions. Some grassroots families may find this a problem. So should we waive the charge? Well, this is something minor. If you waive the charge, but they may become big wasters because they don't have to pay for the garbage bags. So there's no pressure on them to reduce waste. So if that is the case, we don't have to implement the waste charging scheme. So I think you should give them more encouragement. Now, for grassroots families, if they reduce their waste by 1 kilogram, you can give them a few free garbage bags. It's better than giving them bags whatsoever for free. for housing estates with property management companies, the management companies would give garbage bags to the households because that's already included in the management fees. So in the future, if it's also done this way, then the households would not feel the pressure of MSW charging. So are you asking all the households to buy their own designated garbage bags? Of course, it will be more effective. So for the rural areas, people also need to buy designated garbage bags. Nobody's going to pay for them. However, for housing estates, the management company would do that. So people living in housing estates would not feel the pressure. Some people have, or some organizations have asked or consulted people. Some of them would indeed try to reduce the load of the waste. Instead of dumping 10 kilograms, they would only dump 5 kilograms. So some tests have been done in Hong Kong, and they have proven to be successful. So Secretary, would you implement the scheme as soon as possible? And in terms of charging, you really have to look at the details. Mr. Leung, thank you for your support. We really want to lay the pressure on Hong Kong landfills, and we want to implement the MSW charging scheme as soon as possible. Dump less, save more is the major principle. So this is the system, and we need to know about the system so that progressively we can reduce the load of our waste in a gradual manner. So when the SDC conducted its public engagement exercise, most of the stakeholders agreed, and they also, and many state buildings also agreed that they should migrate to the new system as soon as possible. Mr. Leung Yuchong, yes, people have been more environmentally friendly in the past years. For example, the recycling of clothes and papers, this have been done in many housing estates in the past years. And also incentives have been provided to them. For example, giving the donors toilet papers as a reward. So you are saying that a lot of people now ask you questions concerning designated garbage bags. Yes, because now people understand more about environmental protection, but it's not that everybody in society understands that. Otherwise, you don't need to legislate. Yes, you said just now that this piece of legislation would just take the lead, and afterwards you will also take other steps. This is the concept. However, some people hate this concept because they don't really want to produce waste. It's the problem of manufacturers. But if they have bought a piece of commodity, they would have to dump the wrappings, for example, the carton boxes, etc. They do not produce such waste. It's the manufacturer that produced the packaging, but now you will penalize the consumer. So you say that this will take the lead and then other steps will follow. So is it fair? Would you adopt a 2, 3, or 4-pronged approach? Otherwise, people will not be convinced. Now, you have a new piece of legislation. You need people to be convinced, but they are not. If they buy a new electrical appliance, it comes with a whole bunch of packaging. So you really have to look into this. Some members suggest now that the devil is in the details. For example, in a housing estate, what if one household does not use a designated garbage bag? It will cause the property management a lot of problem, and even for a small private waste collector, this would mean a huge issue. So how are you going to solve these problems? Yes, thank you for your questions. Now, this is like the locomotive. It will be the head of a whole train. So we are not only targeting households. And for the commercial and industrial sector, they would also have to think about this. That is, how will they package their products in the future? This has to change too, because this is the society's demand. For example, if you want to buy refuel in the market, there is still not a lot of demand for refuel in the market. So that's why not many shops are selling this. So we really need to have a clear roadmap and a timetable so that everybody would know that we need to reduce waste.
And the business sector will also change. Before the preparatory stage, we are going to communicate with the business sector in order to have reduction of waste at source when they produce their products. Next, Mr. Lam Kwok Hong. Mr. Secretary, I live in a housing estate. Every day, I have to dump refuse, but the plastic bags are not good plastic bags, and the residents are telling me I should talk to you, they say. The bag is small and it's not holding the rubbish. And secondly, Hong Kong, I think, is a hypocritical society. In Mong Kok, I have tried dumping a plastic bottle in a recycling bin. I have been holding it all the way to Admiralty and I can't find a recycling bin. I leave Admiralty Station and I can't do it on the footbridge, not even here in Lechko. This is real. You always say Hong Kong is crowded, but in some MTR stations you can even have a soccer match, and they want to make money, so they set up shops. You can buy anything at MTR stations now. Have you thought about placing 7 bins in MTR stations? There is none. Nothing. I have checked it myself. You can take a site visit with me. And in my estate, there are only 3 bins. They can't hold all the rubbish. And also, is it that the separated waste is really handled separately? I have talked to you about this for 2 years. And I'm telling you, I live in an estate. Most estate residents don't leave the food waste at home because it's dirty. And I'm asking you to go for global tendering to come up with an easy-to-use food waste bin. Give us something. Give us a product which is usable, but nothing. You have done nothing. You told me, Mr. Leung, don't filibuster on the landfills. And I'm asking you whether you're really going to do something. And then 1 or 2 years have passed. To me, there is no improvement. And I wonder if the color bins are helping us to separate waste at source. I have asked you whether those collected items are recycled. There is a lot of space in my estate. Elderly people take the newspapers to sell, they donate clothes. I'd like to ask you when there can be 7 bins in all the major thoroughfares in Hong Kong for glass, for plastic, and other materials. I want to dump some clothes, but I don't know where to. Thank you. If you walk from Admiralty Station to government offices, there are bins before you leave the station. Wait, I will ask members here. I can answer you. Where are they? Well, there are some. If you walk on the footbridge from Admiralty to come to Legco, there are the bins on the first floor near the government offices. But what if I walk on the other side? No, it's not Admiralty Center. Maybe the bureau chief can answer you. I have really seen them. And then I walk up. What kind of building is that? There are only 20 seconds. You want the bureau chief to answer you? Exactly. To tie in with this charging scheme, we have set up a committee in order to review the facilities for recycling in common spaces. And this will be done in the next 2 years. I will make this proposal. Put up a paper figure of Ms. Tanya Chan and let us know where the recycling bins are. Because I sometimes can't use that path. Okay, it's my turn. The Civic Party supports the paper. And also, this policy, which has been long coming, and we expect the law to come soon, but then many residents think that there will be implementation difficulties. Maybe it will take 2 years to pass the law, and we expect the administration to grasp the opportunity to do good education. At the same time, maybe you are thinking of actual implementation, but I think there are other things you need to consider. I hope we can have a public hearing so the residents can tell us their worries. As Mr. Leung Kwok Hong was saying, where can we set up more conspicuous bins, but then they should not be intrusive. Perhaps Big Waster can come along and help us. The Bureau does not have to respond because we don't have much time anyway. Let's see whether you need to respond anyway. Before we close the discussion, I have heard... Sorry, Mr. Nathan Law, I will allow you to ask questions and then we'll discuss the hearing issue. I'd like to ask some follow-up questions. Recycling bins. I have been reading up information, and the MSW recycling now in Hong Kong is at 35%, and recycling is affected by the global market and there is volatility. The recycling industry has said that there is a lot impact on the ecology of the industry when business is not good. What can you do about it? Because it's heavily reliant on the market situation. If we want to help the environment, the government must put in more resources to help the recycling industry. Will you be doing something to improve the very volatile operating environment of the trade? Thank you. First, the recycling industry actually supports the MSW charging scheme, so there will be a value tagged to the different recyclable materials, and clean recycling will also be encouraged. This will help the sustainable development of their industry. Right now, some don't apply for the recycling fund because they can't see a prospect. But if there is a timetable for charging by volume, they will have confidence. The recycling fund has enough resources to support applications. Number three, if there are low-valued materials like glass, which is heavy and difficult to transport, we'll build a system so that glass will assume a recycling value. The same can go for plastic bottles. We are quite willing to intervene so that there can be recycling and reuse of low-valued products. This will relieve the pressure at landfills, and there will be more recycling done so the industry can develop healthily. Well, I hope you will actually do it, because this has not just happened in recent years. You can see the colored bins. Many of them don't go to recycling reception areas, but they just go to landfills. Well, this is exactly the opportunity to do this. The colored bins are taken to a place in the NT for sorting metal, plastic and papers will be handled separately, but some people don't really respect the bins. Half of the waste collected in these color bins is just rubbish. When we launch the charging scheme, we will redesign the bins and we will inculcate a culture of clean recycling, so people will support the color bins. I understand. I only have 30 seconds. I understand that grassroots will face a problem. When I met you, you said you would do something. If you can't give any undertaking in this respect, grassroots will be worried because this means more expenses for them. 5 seconds. We have a different treatment for CSSA families. Thank you. Thank you very much. We have overrun on this item by a wide margin for that matter. Any objection to a public hearing? No? Okay. Maybe we need a whole day. You will have to be prepared to spend the time. And the PAC issued the transfer, or actually referral memo, saying that there should be a review done on the policy outline on MSW management for 2005 to 2014, and the administration should report the review results to this panel at the appropriate time. Second item, many people have been waiting for long in the public gallery, and I beg your pardon. Since we have overrun by half an hour, perhaps we will only allow 3 minutes for each member. Maybe you should raise your hand first. This is progress of government's efforts on nature conservation and marine conservation and legislative proposal to phase out the local ivory trade. We have got 3 papers, one from the administration, another one from the secretariat, and actually 2 from the secretariat. First, I'd like to thank the administration, including Ms. Christine Low, Undersecretary, and other people from the EPD and the AFCD. Thank you very much for coming. Now I can ask the administration to briefly introduce the paper, please. Undersecretary. Thank you, Chairman. Not too long ago, we told you that we'll go down the legislative route to tighten the ivory trade. By 2021, local trading will be banned. Before members ask questions, I hope we'll have the opportunity to briefly introduce to you the proposed ban, together with the public and members. We found that perhaps people are a little confused about the existing system. What is important is that you should understand the present situation before we can take a look at the proposal. Before my colleague does the introduction, I'd like to say that this will take us to the end of 2021, and that is, there will be a ban locally. But we are following the international trend. You may know that in the country now, by the end of this month, there will be the first round of banning. And by the end of the year, there will be a total ban throughout the country. My colleague can give you the details if you like. Can I ask Dr. So to introduce to you the present ban? Thank you. Deputy Director Dr. So of AFCD. Or is it for Mr. Simon Chan? Mr. Chan then. Thank you, Chair. I will now introduce to you the present ban and future control. Starting from 1990, African elephants have been included in the CITES, Convention on International Trade in Endangered Species of Wild Fauna and Flora. But in the 1980s, Hong Kong was the ivory trading center for Asia. Before the international ban, a lot of post-convention ivory has been imported into Hong Kong legally. We allow the trading of such ivory after registration and a license to possess, but we ban the re-export of such ivory. And also, according to CITES, there are a few types of ivory which can be exempted, and including pre-convention ivory, meaning the ivory has been the subject of certification before the convention, and also hunting trophies and certain specified ivory carvings and ornaments. After the gradual phasing out of trading in ivory, if you possess any ivory for the purpose of business, that will be banned. And apart from local banning, the pre-convention ivory hunting trophies and special carvings and ornaments will also be banned. But if you possess ivory for non-commercial purposes and also for import-export, and also if it is your own or your family's treasure, you can still continue to possess them. According to AFCD business survey, we found that ivory does not belong to the main traded item for many traders. Many of them have actually already transformed to take up other trade which are not regulated. For example, trading of mammoth ivory. And some people actually store the not exhausted ivory at home. This will show that a ban will not even affect the traders.
There will be a 5-year transitional period. And we are not asking the industry to sell out all the inventory in 5 years. The transitional period is to give the traders an appropriate period of time to handle their inventory. The buying and selling of inventory is only one of the channels. So for the ivory holders, after the ban, they can still keep the ivory for non-commercial purposes. For example, they can keep it in their families as heirlooms or send it to others as gifts. So this is my brief introduction. Well, there are not many members here, so it doesn't matter if we overrun. Now, I'll give 4 minutes to each member. First, Siu Kafei. Thank you, Madam Chair. Lately, I've received a lot of emails, in particular emails from overseas. They asked me to support this paper. Hong Kong is an international city. Doing business is important. Conservation is also very important. Now, for this paper, if it bans all trade in ivory, then elephants will not be killed. This is the basic logic. I'm the representative of the wholesale and retail sector. Some members of the trade understand this. Yes, if they sell post-convention ivory, then people will kill elephants, and it's really a tragedy. But you have to remember this. In the past, in China's tradition, ivory is art. So for the craftsmen, they only know that this is a piece of material for them to carve. So when ivory is given to the craftsmen for processing, they were just slabs. They were not in the shape of an elephant's tooth. So for traditional craftsmen, it will be very difficult for them to make a livelihood afterwards. And for people who have bought ivory many years ago, it's their asset. So when the government decides on this policy, people started to refuse buying and selling ivory. Nobody knows whether the ivory is still worth money, but some people may have spent their whole lives saving on ivory. Well, you are saying that in the future, ivory cannot be bought or sold. So definitely, the price of ivory will fall. So for traditional craftsmen and for people keeping ivory, is this fair? Businessmen have been talking to us. They are not selling dangerous drugs. If you've told them earlier, of course they would not have bought ivory. But ivory has been allowed to be traded in Hong Kong, so they have bought the ivory. So now they are asking the government to buy out their ivory so that they can have some saving and they can live on. Deputy Director, thank you for your questions. We have communicated with the member. AFCD has also talked to the industry. As for pre-convention ivory, in theory, they belong to elephants that died a long time ago. But we have taken the issue of law enforcement into consideration. We have in one go banned all the trading in ivory. So in terms of law enforcement, it will help a lot. First, we do not have to examine whether the ivory belongs to post-convention or pre-convention. Well, the trade criticized this because they thought that people might try to mix up ivory. However, this is the international trend. At the Conference of the Parties to CITES, the parties adopted a resolution. That is for all parties and non-parties, they would ban ivory trade in the future. So a source, this can tackle the elephant killing problem. Madam Chair, I hope that a public hearing can be held. Yes, thank you. We will be seeing the amendment bills soon. Anyway, Elizabeth Court, I have been talking to the government. Hong Kong is a black market for ivory. If we really want to protect African elephants from extinction, we have to make some effort. In 2010, I moved it. Several years ago, I moved a motion and it was carried by the whole council. And now the government has finally come up with an amendment bill. I've heard a lot of views. We have received letters from all over the world asking us to ban local trade in ivory, to plug the loophole. At the same time, we understand that there are some ivory traders in Hong Kong and they object to this. Now they have given us a lot of reasons. Some people say that, well, for the buying and selling of ivory in Hong Kong, African elephants will not be affected. And some people say that, well, they don't have to kill elephants nowadays. They just take off their teeth. Well, I want to show you this. I think many Hong Kong people do not know about this. Killing elephant to get its teeth is a very cruel thing. If you want to get the most valuable ivory, you have to kill the elephant. because the teeth grows from its jaw to its nose bone. So you have to kill the elephants. You have to cut off the face of the elephant before you can remove the teeth. And then you will get the most valuable ivory. Some people allege that they just wait till the elephant die and then they will get their teeth. This is totally unbelievable. And now there's a proposed period of 5 years. I have been struggling a lot. Now we only have 400,000 elephants left. How can we wait for 5 years? I think in 10 years' time, only a small number of elephants will be left. Fortunately, lot of countries are aware of this. EU countries and many countries have already legislated against it, and even China is going to do this within this year. There are not many places that will still allow trading in ivory, so there's no business to do because the whole world knows that they cannot do this anymore. This is too cruel. And if our other countries ban this within 1 year and only Hong Kong bans this within 5 years, then Hong Kong will become the largest black market in the whole world. So the government would have to do more against smuggling. And a lot of traders say that the government should buy out the ivory inventory. I object to that because that will give a value to ivory and more ivory will be imported into Hong Kong. Well, we already thought that there were only about 300 license holders in the past, but actually this number can go up. And I've heard that there were only 70 tons of ivory in Hong Kong, but still, this is not the limit. The inventory can still go up. So before the government enforce the law, the tonnage of ivory will go up. Is this report true? Well, I can give you some of my time, Ms. Quart, who will answer this question. Please give her a succinct answer. Well, on the last point, Dr. So, according to our present regulatory system, if it can be proved that the ivory was imported into Hong Kong before the convention, then a person can apply for a license to possess. Well, because that's for commercial possession. In the past, if it's not for commercial possession, if it's only for personal possession, that's okay. And now if you want to apply for commercial possession, you can do that. But you have to prove that you imported the ivory into Hong Kong before the convention. Mr. Yu Chung-Yi, Mr. Yu's microphone has not been turned on. He's not coming through. Yes, I support this, but I have a question. Well, we have another issue to discuss, that is about the biodiversity strategy and action plan. And there are numerous key areas, specific action items and action categories, but not much resources are provided. But will the government create a biodiversity fund? Because in the coming 3 years, 360 billion dollars will be put on infrastructural projects, but only 150 million dollars will be put on biodiversity. So can we create a biodiversity fund so that the work can be carried out more efficiently? The government's position is that it will not be amending any legislation because of the Biodiversity Strategy and Action Plan, BSAP. Will the government change its mind? Well, your first question is about money. You might have mixed up. Well, for that amount of money is for AFCD. However, if there are other items or projects, for example, if we are going to set up more marine parks or country parks, then the money can come from other budgets, so you don't need to mix them up. Second, about legislation. Well, for the BSAP, we've said that in the coming 5 years, we will try to do some things as soon as possible. However, if it's about other policy changes, they will not be done within the first 5 years of BSAP. So in the coming few years, there will not be major changes. But of course, if there are issues that the community wants to discuss, we can look at the relevant procedures. But for the BSAP procedures, we have certain principles. That is, that we will do certain tasks first. Some tasks will be left for later. Any follow-up? Well, this is quite a good news. But for other, for the $150 million under AFCD, will some of them be spent on BSAP initiatives, or will a fund be set up so that more work can be done? We may not need to look at it this way now, because we already have the Environment and Conservation Fund, and in the policy address, some new concepts have been raised. For example, a countryside fund may be set up. So there are other funds that may be used. As for that $150 million will be given to AFCD for its operation. Well, can AFCD tell us what will be done with the $150 million? Mr. Chen? To implement BSAP, the $150 million is for AFCD to do education and publicity. Some conservation actions will also be included. And there will also be an increase in manpower. The $150 million will also be used to do that. So other than doing all these, some funding will be used for NGOs so that they can do publicity and education in terms of biodiversity.
Before I ask Mr. Eddie Chu to ask questions, you may have seen a motion tabled by Mr. Leung Yu Chung. Later on, after we have completed our discussion, we will handle this motion. Mr. Eddie Chu. Thank you, Chair. I support the proposal of government. I hope it will be implemented ASAP. The Complaints Division has received the sector, and they have told us their own version. And I'd like to ask a question, because in 1990, right? Was it 1990, Chairman? Did I get it right? Starting from 1990, there is the ban on import and export. At that time, the AFD and later the AFCD, in implementing that system, did you send a message to the trade then that sooner or later, no local trading will be allowed? Starting from the 90s, it is a kind of grace period for you to exhaust your stock. So what did you tell them at that time? If you did not send that message out at that time, does it mean that people understood it to be that they could still trade? ivory locally. Do you have a record that the doctor, so we could not find the relevant record, but if we look at the tightening of the international ban, actually starting from mid-2005, we had continuous liaison with the industry to introduce the stepped-up control throughout the world in China and also in Hong Kong and the trend that they can expect. And with regard to measures to gradually phase out ivory trade locally, that was mentioned very clearly in the policy address last year. Second question. Some members, including myself, would like the administration to reconsider shortening the period. I have heard AFCD say that this will be difficult according to the law, because the licensing period under the present law is 5 years. I'd like to ask whether it is possible to propose it now so we can advance the date of banning. Is there a way to do it? Undersecretary, we have sought legal advice because this is an important point. If we look at other places, including the mainland, they use a short period. And in Hong Kong, we use a license system. And the license to re-export is for 5 years. And before the end of last year, we were announcing that the period would be shortened. And the final date is end 2021. That would be the date for total ban. Can that be advanced? Our legal advice is that in order to reduce the possibility of litigation or disputes, we'll just allow these licenses to expire. They will not be renewed. Mr. Chu, but if there is litigation, I don't understand something. When you ban the sale of something, but people can continue to possess it, and they can trade the materials or products if they are before a certain date, I'd like to know whether there have been precedents and whether those have been the subject of legal challenge. Well, I can say this. Whatever government it is, it can change its policies. And it depends what the law allows you to do or what is the best practice. Here, to respect the license system, we have chosen to start the ban locally at the end of 2021. Mr. Leung Yuchong, Chairman, it is said that there is no record about 1990, but I remember very clearly in 1990 there was the colonial government, and that government used a lot of resources to help the craftsmen to change trade, meaning that this trade will come to an end. Or else, why would the colonial government spend 5 years to help the workers or craftsmen change trade? So the attitude was clear. You could dig up the records. I'm sure there will be such records that the workers or craftsmen were helped to change trade. I believe the people in the trade should understand the situation. That is not something new. But the question is, at the end of this year, as the Undersecretary said, China will stop the trade. What will happen to Hong Kong? Hong Kong is a very important trading center internationally. If it is banned in China, Hong Kong will be an even bigger market. If we do not implement the ban, there will be a lot of negative consequences because we don't dovetail with the mainland. I therefore expect that we should dovetail with the practice of the mainland, or else I can't see how we can be effective in dealing with this matter. You won't be able to examine the ivory and testify whether it is pre- or post-convention. People can always contest to say that it is pre-convention and they should be able to continue to sell it. And then you would not have any tools you can use. But of course, you can tell me that there are immense resources in your hands and you can always do the testing. Because I don't want any act to condone illegal acts. I think I'm most concerned about this. That is why I'm going to move the motion, even if the administration has said that there may be legal problems if you want to dovetail with the mainland and ban the sale totally at the end of the year. You said you would respect the license system, but I want you to rethink it. Because as Ms. Elizabeth Quart was doing, you are not implementing it just overnight. The trade should have got the message because they had been told a long time ago. And we expect that after the law is passed, there should be heavy penalties to act as a deterrent. Number three, we hope the administration will do more publicity and education. We hope the public will understand that people are killing the elephants when they take away the tusks. I hope you will provide more education to let the public know more about this trade. Thank you, Mr. Leung. I think Mr. Leung has used the time to explain his motion. I think Mr. Leung and Ms. Quart have said something and I subscribe to what they said. However, just like to explain the so-called dovetailing. The two members said that since there would be a few years grace period, we don't want all illegal activities to come to Hong Kong. I hope members can read para 8 of the paper, step 2. That is important. After the law takes effect, within 3 months of commencement of legislation, all import-export will be banned. After that is done, that is step 2, if we should catch anybody involving in import-export, they will be breaking the law. And in the paper, we have explained that the penalties are enhanced. And I hope members will think about this point. The most important thing is for step 2 to take place. We want to be able to table the legislation to LegCo as soon as possible, and after it is supported, then whether it's pre-convention, post-convention, export and import, it will be banned totally 3 months after the legislation is supported. Deputy Chairman, Mr. Junius Ho. I personally support this proposal and legislation to phase out poaching. However, I have some questions on my mind, and I think we need to balance among a few things. Well, there are 71 tons inventory in the trade. If they are to be totally illegalized, would there be any compensation? If yes, how much public money are we talking about? I hope the trade will get the compensation they are entitled to under the basic law, because that is their right. Number 2, the ivory trade or ivory engraving is a very important traditional art. You know, they can carve 40 layers within a piece, and this is also our heritage. If we can apply to the United Nations and call this a tangible heritage, I'm sure we'll succeed. But we have to balance against two things. there are 470,000 African elements. Starting from 1975, apart from poaching, does it mean that there has been conservation of the species? If yes, the situation should be different. I'm saying we should make poaching illegal. But there are 470,000 elephants, and the natural death rate is 2.3% or 11,000 every year. And 165 tons of ivory will be available naturally. If we can tap that resource so that this particular art can be preserved, I hope we have some space for that. Of course, we want to end illegal poaching. There should be heavy penalties for that. But what about the elephants who die naturally? We can make use of their tusks without wasting resources. And we can then keep our cultural heritage. I'd like to know whether there is space to do this.
Let's answer the first question first. That's important too. We have conducted a lot of studies as to whether compensation should be made. The Deputy Director will answer the question. Well, thank you for your question. With regard to compensation, we have looked at different pieces of legislation. We have also thought about the relevant policies. In the opening speech, we have already mentioned this. In the 90s, we started to regulate ivory trade, and in the 90s, we banned the import and export of post-convention ivory. Now, after we banned the local trade in ivory, there can be no more trading in ivory. But we are not confiscating these private assets. So for the ivory owners, they can still keep the ivory as souvenirs, or they can exhibit them. So we are not taking away the assets of people. So the government will not make any compensation. And earlier on, we've conducted a study in the trade, and Mr. Chen also mentioned that. Now, for the traders who originally were involved in ivory trade, now that ivory trade is no longer their major work, they have transformed, and many of them are selling other items, for example, mammoth ivory. So after the ban commences, it doesn't mean that these businessmen will lose their business immediately. So that's why we will not be making any compensation. And I would like to stress on a point. As I said just now, banning trade in ivory is an international trend. Many countries have already done so, and in the future there will be more stringent measures. Other countries are not making compensations as well. So if we suddenly suggest this, then this may enhance poaching and more ivory will be smuggled to Hong Kong. Thank you. Your time is up. Shokawa and Yik Chiming will be asking questions. And Elizabeth Kwok, yes, you have spoken already. If that's the case, I'll extend the meeting by 10 minutes because we still have to handle Mr. Leung Yucheng's motion. I'll draw a line here. Mr. Siu Kafei. Thank you. Many members have expressed their views. Now the mainland is going to ban ivory trade very soon, so we have to follow suit. Well, but for Hong Kong's legal system, it's very different from that of the mainland. We have our core values. We have to follow our own procedures. We have our rights to properties. Now, on the mainland, if you want to build an airport somewhere tomorrow, all the buildings there will be gone. But this would not happen in Hong Kong. As for ivory traders, they have talked to me. Now, if there is an artwork that was created before 1976. Why would you want to stop it from trading? It's a piece of art. So you can set up a registration system, register all these art pieces that were created before 1976, then people cannot use this as an excuse to kill more elephants. And also the trade really hopes that there can be a public hearing so that the public would know that they are really in dire straits. Dr. So, Madam Chair, I would like to add a word. For 1976, it's not I who said that. The EU is adopting this system. Mr. Chen, under our plan, antique ivory can be exempted. So for the definition of ivory, we have taken reference from other countries' practices. For EU, it's before 1947. It's 50 years before CITES. As for the mainland and the US, is even 100 years before that. So now we have taken the actual situation into consideration and we set the date at 50 years before the implementation of CITES. Carvings, there are different styles at different periods. For example, the Qing Dynasty style is very different from later day style. So for antique ivory, an exemption will be granted so that we can preserve tradition and at the same time we can tell whether piece is indeed that old. So now the date is set at 1925. Ms. Quad, I'm sorry, I can only give you 2.5 minutes due to the time constraints. Mr. Yik Shiming, I agree with Mr. Junior's host's view. If you suddenly impose a ban and there's no compensation, then there would be problems. I do not agree with with the deputy director. Well, these people are supposed to sell their ivory, so you can't just ask them to exhibit the ivory. It's their business, so you really have to be sympathetic to them. They have made an investment. They were supposed to do business, and suddenly now you ban them from doing the business. So of course they should be compensated. So I support that a public hearing be held. I would like to repeat, as for our system, we already have a license system. So after the expiry of the license in 5 years' time, we will impose a total ban. We respect Hong Kong's legal system. That's why we are doing this. Mr. Hu Qifeng, I will be succinct. Now, first of all, I would like to state my position. I support the government's proposal to totally ban ivory trade in Hong Kong. Because, well, all over the world, ivory trade leads to the killing and even extinction of elephants. So now you've been talking about compensation. I'm inclined to support the government. That is not to make any compensation. Well, we are not trying to stifle the trade. I understand that they may face a lot of difficulties. Well, the whole world is tightening the control on ivory trade. But the government didn't make an announcement of banning ivory trade very early on, so they really have difficulties. But what the trade has done did damage the environment and wildlife. So if you do not make compensation, you would send a good message to the public, and this is good education. That is, when it comes to using natural resources and wildlife for making money, you really have to think twice. So I support the government's decision of not making compensation. Thank you. And now I'll ask questions. The Civic Party totally supports this proposal. And even in my platform, I said that we shouldn't wait for 5 years. However, for the present licensing regime, there is a system, and each time if you renew a license, you can get 5 years. Just now, Dr. Elizabeth Kwok's photo was very shocking. That photo shows how people kill an elephant just to get the tusk. So if you want to get ivory, you have to murder the elephant. It's not like what other people alleged. The elephant won't just lose their tusk naturally. We know that there is a lot of education we need to do, and even by stepping up the penalty, many people may not understand why. So it may take a very long time. Many people are not eating shark's fin anymore. So for ivory, we have to do some education. The government cannot just rely on green groups or NGOs. It has to take actions. We hope that the ban can be implemented as soon as possible. Just now, the government said that by the end of this year, ivory trade will be completely banned on the mainland. Have you assessed whether that will bring about any impact on Hong Kong? So, will the government answer my questions? The officers from AFCD will tell you about law enforcement. Well, this is a three-step plan. In June, we will be tabling this piece of legislation, and if members can pass the law fast, for example, by the end of this year, then we will start step two. It will commence 3 months. That is in 3 months. That is March 2018. Then all the importing and exporting of ivory will be illegal. Mr. Chen? Our plan is like this. After 5 years, ivory trade in Hong Kong will be phased out. Well, on the mainland, they will be doing this by the end of this year. We have talked to the customs. There may be smuggling of ivory, so they will step up their efforts. We will join hands with the customs and Interpol, and we will exchange intelligence. We have also trained some sniffer dogs to guard against the smuggling of ivory. Also, we will be using high technology to check the ivory and see if it belongs to pre-convention or post-convention period. So we will adopt a number of measures to combat the illegal smuggling of ivory. Second round, Dr. Elizabeth Kwok, 2.5 minutes. I'm sorry about that. Thank you, Madam Chair. Just now, Mr. Siu Ka-wai said that even EU allows the trading of ivory before 1976, but not all EU countries do that. France, Germany, the Netherlands, Sweden, they do not allow the import and export or trading in ivory of any age. There is not a business that can be permanent. in particular if that business is built on wildlife. From the 90s up to now, originally we had 700 tons and now only 70 tons left. So 90% of the inventory have been sold. Only 10% are left. So if you do business, there is risk. Nobody will guarantee that you can sell all your inventory. So the government can decide as to whether a license is issued. Otherwise, there will be no licensing system. So for this ban is based on a very important reason. It's not against Hong Kong's business principles. So I support the government's legislative proposal. As for Mr. Liang Yuchong's motion, yes, we all want the phasing out period to be shortened to 1 year. So can you explain to Mr. Liang Yuchong why can't you shorten it to 1 year? What consequence are we talking about? I'm afraid that this will affect the legislative timetable. So can the government explain to us? Deputy Director, Undersecretary. Now, with respect Hong Kong system, that is the licensing system, it would give the licensees a period of 5 years.
That's fine. We'll allow until end 2021 for import and export. But the most important thing is step two. Step two is really the most important step. Once we support the ordinance, then import and export will be totally banned after 3 months. You cannot try to mix up the inventory, and there will be no inappropriate trading. As I said, the meeting will be extended by 10 minutes. Mr. Leung, there will be no amendment to your motion, right? I have a typo there. The grace period should be 5 years and not 2 years. I'll give you 2 minutes. I'd like to differ from one viewpoint. At the end of the year, China will impose a total ban. I was talking about dovetailing, but not by way of legislation. Because if we don't dovetail with the country, there will be an aftermath to be faced. Of course, we have different legal systems. I'm not saying our system should be the same as China's, but we may have to suffer from the consequences of the ban in China. This is the most important point, Undersecretary. You say there is step two, but we hope the vacuum period to be as short as possible, and that is why I'm proposing 1 year. If by March it is okay, then it is not a big difference from 1 year. I just want to tighten it a bit. Is that your understanding as well, Undersecretary? Any response? We understand it differently. It seems you say it should be total ban for the possession of ivory for the purpose of trading, but that is a different matter, Mr. Leung. It is about possession. Maybe I should let you explain. I'm saying it should be implemented within a year. I know some members don't support it, but I want to express my own view. It's all right for you to differ from my view. I just like to express this message. If we don't dovetail with the total ban in China, then Hong Kong would become a center for illegal and illegal trade. That is my biggest worry. I agree with that. But we can use step two to dovetail with the country's initiative. But then step two is about trading, not possession. Right, it's about import-export, but possession is different. I can't control possession. You can possess ivory, but not to import and export it. I'm asking Mr. Liang Yuchong whether you are worried about black market activities. Yes. Then I'm saying step two can prevent it. The mainland will impose a total ban by the end of the year. And if by March 2018 we can implement this, then, well, the interim period would be very short. If they want to have illegal import into Hong Kong, then I can apprehend those culprits. Okay, I think members understand the motion. I don't know whether members may want to comment on the voting, but please read the motion and then register your stance. Under bracket 1, to shorten the 5-year grace period as proposed. And Mr. Leung Yew-chung, please tell me how you want to amend your motion. Well, I can amend the words possession. Why don't you say import-export? And Undersecretary, what do you think if I make this change? Well, you are talking about local trading, right? Yes. Well, let me do this. Mr. Leung, while you seek to amend the motion, let us talk about the hearing. Mr. Leung, you can discuss with members your motion in the meantime. I must tell members frankly that with regard to these two important matters discussed today, you agree that there should be a public hearing on MSW charging. I believe many stakeholders are involved and it may take a long time. And it will be difficult for us to find a date in the immediate period. And about ivory trade, the administration promised that the amendment bill will come to this council in June. And to be frank, we'll certainly set up a bills committee. Why don't we hold the public hearing when we have a bills committee so the sector can come and represent their views? Mr. Tommy Jiang. Chairman, it is not a very good arrangement. I think we have held public hearings before the legislation is proposed. We should not hold a hearing after the bill is tabled. We have done that many times. We can have public hearings both before and after the introduction of legislation. We have done that many times. I think we should not hold public hearings continuously as we like it. And if you don't think you want a hearing, then we should hold it only after a bills committee is set up. Mr. Xiu Ka-fai, I think we need to give the opportunity for stakeholders to express their views. As Mr. Tommy Cheng said, it is not meaningful when the bill has been drafted. As for the length of the hearing, it depends how many people are coming. If not many people are coming, maybe 2 hours will suffice. And I'm telling you, those people in the public gallery have cried in front of me. You have to give them a chance to cry in front of the public. Well, certainly there will be a hearing. I'm just talking about the time, because this is controversial and it must be held before the bill comes to us. Let us try to find a time before June. We will do our very best. And we will have a public hearing before the tabling of the bill. And coming back to the motion, Mr. Leung Yew-chung, can you let us know how you have amended the motion? Undersecretary, you say if the step 2 can be implemented by mid to next year, I will withdraw the motion. Okay, you want to withdraw the motion. Thank you very much. I believe we have all the views expressed. And as I said, in June 2017, there will be an amendment bill tabled at LegCo. If there are no views, we'll go to the last item, any other business. If there is nothing under AOB, we'd like to thank members for coming. Meeting is adjourned.